Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alright. Sorry guys. Forgot to turn my airplane mode on, so my phone is always going off like crazy. Lots of calls, so. Okay. Hopefully now we're good, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So today we are at juzz 25. Day 25 of Ramadan and juzz 25. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah, time is moving. And obviously Ramadan has moved very, very, very fast. And subhanAllah, we are in the last stretch, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for you and I, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to do that which is most pleasing to Him, and to accept Laylatul Qadr from us, to allow us to witness Laylatul Qadr, and to accept it from us. Subhanallah, a lot of times we skip that part, the part of asking for acceptance. So it's not just being able to witness the ibadah, but it's also important to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for acceptance. And that's something that I just want to remind all of you with. Obviously, there are a lot of programs that you might have seen popping up in the last few days, in the last few nights. So there's a reflection session that we actually do at Valley Ranch Masjid. On the last 10 nights, myself and Sheikh Yasser Bajas actually alternate with them. So I invite you guys to tune into that, inshallah ta'ala, and to really, you know, try to make the most of these last 10 nights. The schedule also, just so you guys know, we have a bit of a complication in that tomorrow I'm doing Salat al-Jum'ah, I'm doing Khutbat al-Jum'ah at 3 o'clock, inshallah. So 3 o'clock meaning 4 p.m. Eastern, which is usually the time that I do 30 for 30. So I'll probably try to do it before Khutbat al-Jum'ah, inshallah ta'ala. Before I do my khutbah at 3 o'clock, I'll try to get juz 26 done, inshallah ta'ala. Or I might do it immediately after Jum'ah. So it'll either be immediately before Jum'ah or immediately after Jum'ah. So let's go ahead and get to the surahs, inshallah. And hopefully we don't get bombarded by people from South America today. That was pretty funny yesterday. But if that does happen, if we do get some bots or we do get people that attack in the middle of the lecture, then I just ask you guys not to pay attention to the comments. All right. So anyway, Surah Fussilat. Just I want to draw your attention to the very end of the surah, and then we'll move on to the other surahs. In the very end of Surah Fussilat, one of the most beautiful verses, Subhanallah, verse 53. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will show them our signs in the farthest horizons of the universe, and then the signs within their own selves, until it becomes manifest to them that this is the truth. What is this? أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referring to when He says, أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ, that this is the truth? Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to the Qur'an. All of the surahs in this juz, in juz 25, start off with a mention of glorification of the Qur'an. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will show you signs in the stars and in the sun and in the moon and in the knowledge of how vast the galaxies and the universe around us is. He'll show us signs in that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He'll draw our attention to nature around us as a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greatness and as a proof of the existence of a creator. He will draw our attention to insects and to animals and so on and so forth. And then sometimes He'll draw attention to the signs within ourselves of His existence and of the proof of a designer subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will draw our attention to all of these signs outside, inside, you know, around us, within us, all for the purpose of what? Until it is made clear to them, حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. Until it is made clear to them that this Qur'an is the truth. Now, that shows you that the goal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the goal of the Qur'an in mentioning these great signs, is not just to arrive at the conclusion of a creator, but to arrive at the conclusion that this is a message that has come from the creator, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is revealing this Quran. So Surah Fussilat is very interesting in that sense. SubhanAllah lays the groundwork. The last part of Surah Fussilat, which is the first part of this juz 25, it lays the groundwork or the framework for everything that is going to come forth, everything that we're going to see in the next few surahs. So as I said, every single surah in this juz starts off with a mention of the Quran. So Surah Ash-Shura, which is the next surah, Ha, Mim, Ayn, Sin, Qaf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ يُوحِي إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ اللَّهُ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that thus He has revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, and to those that came before you, Allah, that, you know, Allah, the exalted in might, the wise, لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. To Him belongs all that is in the heavens and all that is in the earth, and He is the Most High and the Most Great. So the concept of revelation and the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending to us this Qur'an so that we could arrive at a place of guidance. And as I said, subhanAllah, in Surah Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He shows you signs in the farthest horizons, and then within yourself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ash-Shura, He mentions تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ, that the heavens almost tear from above them, right? That, so He drew attention to the heavens in Surah Fussilat, and in Surah Ash-Shura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, these heavens and the skies and the universe almost tears from above them. And وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Once again, the angels seeking forgiveness for us. So subhanAllah, just like the last juz, every surah mentioned the angels comforting us once again here. And the angels declare the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they seek forgiveness for those that are on the earth. أَلَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-forgiving and the most merciful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the words of shirk, the words of associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of denial and rejection of God, that they almost tear the heavens and the earth, and at the same time the glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would almost tear the skies above us, the amount of angels that are glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah drew our attention to the horizon in the previous surah, and now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it to us once again. In verse 7, subhanAllah, in the last few surahs, we saw this emphasis on the comforting of the people of paradise. لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. They don't need to fear, they don't need to grieve. We saw a lot of discussion about the two groups. So in the previous juz, you had the conversation between the people of hellfire and the people of heaven. You had the conversations within Jannah, within paradise, between the people of paradise, and the conversations within hellfire, and so on and so forth. And subhanAllah, verse 7 of this surah was the most difficult verse in the Quran for our great Khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah ta'ala, for the great leader of this ummah, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah ta'ala. His wife said that the most difficult verse in the Quran for him was verse 7 of this Quran, particularly the last part of it where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ, that a group of them will be in paradise and a group of them will be in the blazing fire. So he used to cry and he used to wonder, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, so to which of the two groups do I belong? So it continues along that same theme, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place people within their various parties, within their various places. You also see in Surah Ash-Shura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes, so there are a few dominant themes. One of the most dominant themes within Surah Ash-Shura is the idea of continuity of the message. So in the beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has revealed to you, وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, and to those that came before you. So the idea of continuity of revelation is a dominant theme within Surah Ash-Shura. So for example, verse 13, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شَرَعَ لَكُم مِّنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى, and so on and so forth, that He has ordained for you of religion what He has enjoined upon Nuh alayhi salam, and that which we revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what we enjoined upon Abraham and Moses and Jesus, peace be upon them all, Ibrahim, Musa, and Isa, alayhi wasalam. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this was something that was given to all of them, an aqim with deen, that they were told to establish the way of God. وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا فِيهِ, and do not find yourselves divided within that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this concept of continuity also in verse 14, وَمَا تَفَرَّقُوا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ, that the only reason why they became divided after divine revelation came to them was because of their arrogance, was because of their egos, was because of their envy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying knowledge came to them, but because of their arrogance and because of their envy, they ended up ruining themselves. So that's one of the dominant themes is continuity. You find this throughout Surah Ash-Shura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizing that this is the same revelation that He gave to those that came before. One of the most beautiful themes though, and in fact the most beautiful and powerful underlying theme of Surah Ash-Shura, is who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Okay, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describing? His attributes. So for example, if you look at verse 11 of Surah Ash-Shura, فَاطِرُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, He is the originator of the heavens and the earth. جَعْلَ لَكُم مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَمِنَ الْأَنْعَامِ أَزْوَاجًا, He made for you from among yourselves mates, and amongst even the cattle, mates. يَذْرَأُكُمْ فِيهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He multiplies you thereby. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, There is nothing like unto Him, and He is the all-hearing and the all-seeing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces Himself in many ways throughout this particular surah. لَهُ مَقَادِيدُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَقْدِرُ إِنَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ, To Him belong the keys of the heavens and the earth. He extends provision for whom He wills, and He restricts it. So يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَقْدِرُ, So this is a meaning of qadr, is to restrict. So He restricts risk to some people. إِنَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ, And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing of how He deals with His creation, of everything that belongs to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how He should distribute it subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions in verse 23, ذَلِكَ الَّذِي يُبَشِّرُ اللَّهُ عِبَادَهُ, that this is it is that of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives glad tidings to His servants. But who of His servants? Who are His ibad? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, those who believe and those who do good deeds. So it is He subhanahu wa ta'ala who gives glad tidings to His servants. And in 25, verse 25, so verse 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives glad tidings and He rewards His servants who do good deeds. Verse 25, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَقْبَلُ التَّوْبَةَ عَنْ عِبَادِهِ وَيَعْفُ عَنِ السَّيِّئَاتِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَفْعَلُونَ, and it is He who accepts the repentance of His slaves, and He forgives sins, and He knows that which you do. So verse 23 mentions that it is He who rewards, and verse 25 mentions that it is He who forgives, and verse 28, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا قَنَطُوا وَيَنْشُرُ رَحْمَتَهُ, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who sends down the rain after they had despair. وَيَنْشُرُ رَحْمَتَهُ, and He spreads out His mercy all around. وَهُوَ الْوَلِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ, and He is the protector, He is the guardian, and the one who is always worthy of praise. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that He's the one that sends down rain after we've given up on Him, after we felt a sense of despair. And what that means is that there are times in our lives where we feel like nothing's going to come back, that we're going to be living in a difficult and constricting situation for the rest of our lives. When is the mercy of Allah coming? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends it after we have despaired. And then from verse 36 to the end of Surah Ash-Shura, who are these ibad of Allah? Who are these slaves of Allah? Who are these servants of God? How do they respond to the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does for them? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from verse 36, فَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so whatever you have been given is but a passing enjoyment for this worldly life, but that which is with Allah is better and more lasting for those who believe and put their trust in their Lord. وَالَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ, that, and they are those who avoid the greater sins and the obvious sins. Now, this is a very interesting way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this, because Allah mentions, again, just previously, that He is the one who accepts the repentance of His servants, and He forgives much. So a believer will inevitably fall into minor sins, and a believer will inevitably make mistakes, and a believer will inevitably do things that he's not supposed to do or she's not supposed to do. But you need to stay away from the major sins and you know, at least al-fawahish, those wicked, open forms of sin and so on and so forth. There's a big difference between the major sins and the minor sins, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you that you pray your five times, that you do your fara'at, you do your mandatory things, and at least always avoid the major sins and avoid the major deeds of wickedness. And then as for the minor sins which you'll inevitably commit, you don't insist on them. But when you inevitably commit them, you seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those who don't indulge within the major sins, they might, you know, may Allah protect us, but some people have fallen into a major sin, a few times in their lives, whatever it may be, but they don't insist. They don't find themselves indulging within major sins. وَإِذَا مَا غَضِبُوا هُمْ يَخْفِرُونَ. And when they are made angered, or when someone upsets them, they also forgive. So they draw from the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they forgive others as well. So it's not just that they expect Allah to forgive them, they also forgive others because they want to be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالَّذِينَ اسْتَجَابُوا لِرَبِّهِمْ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَ بَيْنَهُمْ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And those who responded to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they established the prayer. So, responded to the call of Allah. Allah mentions in the beginning of the surah that this was the call to all of His prophets and all of their people. Aqamu salah, they established the prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that He gave the command to establish the religion, to establish the prayer to all of the prophets that came before. Now, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Led them astray, led them to arrogance, to ruin, and to competition over the religious authority and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, here, وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَ بَيْنَهُمْ. And the way that the believers judge their affairs is through mutual consultation, is through shura. Shura is one of the most important qualities of our religion, right? It is the true manifestation of a democratic process, all right? It's not, every democracy means many, many, many different things, and I'm not getting into that. But in Islam, the idea of consultation, the idea of people having their voices heard, of the Prophet ﷺ even consulting with his companions and so on and so forth. So the believers don't have, you know, they don't compete over religious authority. They don't, you know, if anything, they're afraid to represent the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they realize how important of a trust that is. Instead, there's consultation amongst them with their affairs. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And they readily spend of that which we have bestowed upon them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَهُمُ الْبَغْيُ هُمْ يَنْتَصِرُونَ. And those who, when an oppressor wrongs them, they take their revenge, but of course they don't go beyond what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed for them. So وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا. That the retribution for an evil act is an evil act just like it. فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. But whoever pardons and who reconciles, so whoever overlooks, remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that He's the one who forgives you, and Allah mentioned that the servants of Allah are the ones who forgive others. But Allah says, in the case that you're wrong, you can take back your retribution, but it has to not exceed that which was done towards you. But فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ, whoever pardons and makes reconciliation, then his reward is due from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will specifically reward those people, those people who forgave solely for His sake and pardon solely for His sake. So this is Surah Ash-Shura. The next surah is Surah Az-Zukhruf. Why are these people, forgiving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why are these people taking the high road? Why are they seeking this and why are they seeking that? Because of the Zukhruf, the ornaments of gold in Jannah. The ornaments of gold in Jannah, subhanAllah. They are ready for the ornaments of gold in Jannah. That's what they're looking forward to. They don't see this as the place of their ultimate happiness, but rather the place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for them. So Surah Az-Zukhruf, once again, Hameem, so it starts off with Huruf Al-Muqatta'at, it starts off with the disjointed letters, Wal-Kitab Al-Mubin, and the clear book, Inna ja'alnahu Qur'anan Arabiyan la'allakum ta'qilun. Indeed, we have made it a pure Arabic Qur'an so that you might be able to understand. وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعْلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. And verily, it, the Qur'an, is in the mother of the mother of the book. So it is in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. The Qur'an is also is preserved within Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, which is Umm al-Kitab here, refers to the tablet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed for everything to be written within it. Everything to be written within it. Everything that has happened, everything that would happen, so on and so forth. It is all written within the preserved tablet. لَدَيْنَا لَعْلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. Indeed, before us it is exalted and full of wisdom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about this book as well. Something that relates to us in Laylatul Qadr, in Surah Al-Dukhan. So we'll get back to that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Qur'an once again to us and the position that it has with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the dominant theme of Surah Az-Zukhruf is the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how we respond to the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. So the favors of Allah and how we respond to the favors of Allah upon us. From verse 9, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَا يَقُولُنَّ خَلَقَهُنَّ الْعَزِيزُ الْعَلِيمُ. If you were to ask them, who has created the heavens and the earth, they would surely respond, they were created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were created by Al-Aziz, Al-Alim, the exalted in might, and the all-knowing. So essentially these people, Quraysh, you know, and the rejectors of the Prophet ﷺ, they had no problem acknowledging that there was a creator. But at the same time, you know, they wanted to associate partners with that creator. They had taken away from the Rububiyyah or the Uluhiyyah, calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Believing that all benefit and harm only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not want to submit themselves to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So fine, there's a creator. They had no problem acknowledging that at times. They would say that it was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِي جَعْلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ مَهْدًا وَجَعْلَ لَكُمْ فِيهَا سُبُلًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. He, it is He who has made the earth for you like a bed, and He has made for you roads therein, in order that you may find your way. Meaning, He's made the earth, subhanahu wa ta'ala, a place where you could travel throughout. He's made the surface of it easy for you to bear. وَالَّذِي نَزَّلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً بِقَدَرٍ فَأَنْشَرْنَا بِهِ بَلْدَةً مَيْتًا كَذَلِكَ تُخْرَجُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and it is He who sends down rain from the sky in measured amounts, and we revive thereby a dead land. Thus you will be brought forth once again. وَالَّذِي خَلَقَ الْأَزْوَاجَ كُلَّهَا وَجَعْلَ لَكُم مِّنَ الْفُلْكِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ مَا تَرْكَبُونَ. And it is He who created the species, all of them. And He made for you of ships and animals, those which you mount. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions all of these different signs that He gives to us, all these different favors, all of these different ways that He's made things easy for us. You know, interestingly enough, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elaborates on the smoothness of the surface, or the way that the surface of the earth is easy to navigate and to travel. You know, subhanAllah, you think about the planets in outer space that have been discovered in recent times, right? The surface of this earth, how easy it is for us to live upon this earth, and the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the climate and the atmosphere beneficial to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about His favors upon us. Now, how do we respond to those favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah mentions specifically the ni'mah of daughters, the blessing of daughters. Now realize this is to a jahili society, to an ignorant society that does not value their daughters. And so if there's a society that doesn't value its daughters, it is a jahili society. It's an ignorant society. But here, in particular, these people took to the extent of female infanticide, where they would actually kill their daughters. They would bury their daughters alive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about how, you know, how could you turn away from such a beautiful ni'mah? So verse 17, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِمَا ضَرَبَ لِلرَّحْمَانِ مَثَلًا ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. And if they are informed of the news, of the birth of that which he has set forth as a parable to the most beneficent, meaning of a girl. And in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى. So it's the same concept here, but they are informed of the news of the birth, which he has set forth as a parable to the most beneficent. His face becomes dark and gloomy, and he is filled with grief. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this idea of people that deny the blessing of a daughter, the blessing of a girl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us, the various blessings that he sends upon them and the way that they respond to those blessings. And one of the key things that we see about these people is that the way they respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that, you know, instead of looking at what they have, they look at what they don't have. And so, for example, when it comes to the revelation in verse 31, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. They said, then why has the Qur'an not been sent down to one of the great men of the two cities? What they meant by that, Mecca and Ta'if, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not send this Qur'an to someone better than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So they deny the blessing of a daughter that's born to them. They deny the blessing of a messenger that's sent amongst them. So subhanAllah, instead of focusing on the blessing of having Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amongst them, who at least spoke their languages and was from the same city, the same tribe, well, not the same full tribe, but the same parent tribe. They had the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amongst them, and instead of, you know, reveling in the benefit and in the beauty of having a messenger, the greatest messenger of Allah amongst them, alayhi salatu wasalam, they instead responded and said, well, why is it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why not us? Why didn't it come to one of us? Why did it have to come to them? Which shows you that there was an ulterior motive to them rejecting the message as it came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was not because the message itself was problematic, it was because they were problematic. So they were fully willing to acknowledge that there is probably a creator, there's probably a designer. And they understood how special this message was, but at the same time, it's not us. Okay, it's not us. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us now, verse 33 to 35, the reward of the people of paradise as they enter into paradise and they have, these large ceilings, and they have these golden platters, and they have these thrones that they sit on and recline upon. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions wazukhrufa and the gold ornaments. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us that everything in this world, everything that is within this dunya, is going to disappear. But at the same time, وَالْآخِرَةُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. At the same time, the hereafter with your Lord is only for the pious. It's only for the righteous. The message here is that this dunya is for everybody. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will distribute His blessings in this dunya for various reasons. And He'll distribute His blessings to everybody in some capacity. But the akhirah, the gold ornaments of the akhirah, and the paradise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes elaborately within this surah and throughout the Quran only belongs to the muttaqeen. It only belongs to the righteous and to the pious. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes this idea of exclusivity to those that responded to His blessings in the proper way. وَلَئِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And when you are grateful, Allah increases you. So if you're grateful for the blessings in this life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you an entire eternity of blessing in the next. So this is Surah Az-Zukhruf. The next surah is Surah Ad-Dukhan. And Surah Ad-Dukhan is interesting because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once again, Allah mentions to us a verse about the Qur'an, حَامِيمْ وَالْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينَ, that this is the clear book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakah," that we have sent it down on a blessed night. "Inna kunna mundhirin," and we were to warn mankind. "Fiha yufraqu kullu amrin hakim," that in that night every matter is decreed. So in the previous surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that the Quran is preserved within the preserved tablet, the Lawh al-Mahfuz. Allah praised Lawh al-Mahfuz. In this surah, Surah al-Dukhan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Laylatul Qadr, that that indeed we sent down the Quran on a blessed night, and in within that night every matter is decreed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that on Laylatul Qadr, not only was the Quran revealed, but every matter is decreed for the year to come within Laylatul Qadr. Everything is written down and decreed for the year to come within Laylatul Qadr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us the specific night in which we are seeking, obviously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, and we are seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Quran having been revealed on this night. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentions to us how the mercy that He has sent down has overwhelmed us. He has overwhelmed us with His blessings. He's overwhelmed us with His mercy. He has sent down His rahmah in so many different ways, in the form of the blessings that we enjoy, as well as in the form of His forgiveness and the manifestation of His forgiveness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then suddenly, those that were not paying attention to the blessings and to the mercy that He was sent, that He has sent to this earth and upon all the people, would be overtaken by a dukhan. They'd be overtaken by a smoke. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that once that comes, once that dukhan comes down, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends it to the earth, everyone is going to recognize that the earth is about to be destroyed, that everything is going to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that which we have been denying is indeed true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us that at that point, what have you left behind? What is your legacy on this earth, within this world? What have you done? When the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to you, how did you use them? Did you wait for the dukhan? Did you wait for the smoke to overwhelm everyone? Did you wait for the blowing of the horn to start to worry about what you have done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Allah mentions to us verse 25. كَمْ تَرَكُوا مِنْ جَنَّاتٍ وَعْيُونَ. How many gardens and springs did they leave behind? And this is specifically talking, by the way, about the people of Fir'aun. But it's a lesson for all of us. How many gardens and springs did they leave behind? وَزُرُوعٍ وَمَقَامٍ كَرِيمٍ. And they left behind green fields and noble sites. Meaning, how many blessings did Allah give them? And how much did they leave behind? وَنِعْمَةٍ كَانُوا فِيهَا فَاكِهِينَ. And they had comfort in which they were completely, delighted. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them gardens, He gave them mansions, He gave them springs, He gave them all of these things, all of these comforts. And they found complete delight within those comforts. كَذَلِكْ وَأَوْرَثْنَاهَا قَوْمًا آخَرِينَ. And just like that, we caused it to be inherited by another group of people. So just like that, everything was taken away from them, the people of Fir'aun, and those that are like Fir'aun. You know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them so many blessings in this world, but they did not use it for the benefit of anybody or anything. All they did was they delighted themselves with that temporary dunya, and they did not think about that which comes afterwards. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, just like that, and another group of people inherited it. Now, of course, in the specific context, this is Bani Israel, the children of Israel, inherited the kingdom and the goods of the people of Fir'aun. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us in the general sense, you know, for us to think as well. What have we left behind? فَمَا بَكَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَا كَانُوا مُنظَرِينَ. Nor the heavens nor the earth wept for them, nor were they given any form of respite, nor were they given any form of relief. مَا بَكَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu mentions that there is a gate to the heavens in a sama' that all of our good deeds go through. They ascend through that gate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's a gate for each and every single one of us to as-sama, a gate through which our dua ascends, a gate through which our good deeds descend. Ascend. So a gate through which our dua ascends, a gate through which our good deeds ascend. So all of our amal tayyib, all of our good things are going through that gate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we pass away, that gate is shut. And so the skies cry, in a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has caused them to cry, not in the way that we cry, but the skies cry because that gate is now shut. So the heavens do not have that gate anymore through which your good deeds used to ascend. and the earth weeps as well. What particular part of the earth? The place of your sujood, the place where you used to prostrate, the place where you used to do good. So the good things that you did for this earth, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned to us a person of knowledge, that even the animals, the fish and the sea, seek forgiveness for a person of knowledge because they used to do well by the earth. They used to do well by the earth. They were natural environmentalists, subhanAllah. So they, you know, they benefited the earth spiritually. They used to have places of sujood. And at the same time, they used to benefit the people of the world. They used to serve the creation of God. They used to serve the earth itself in the sense of keeping it clean and making sure that the amana of the earth was taken care of and so on and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that wicked people, when they pass away, despite all the blessings that have been given to them, nor the heavens nor the earth shed a tear for them. Or the people of the earth, subhanAllah. They completely neglected the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them. So they were left completely completely worthless. Once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took them away, there was nothing that they benefited. There was nothing that they left behind that was meaningful. There is no resume that they have with the people or with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would show that they were a people who were worth keeping on this earth. So if they messed up with the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it was given to them here, why should Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them with ni'mah in the hereafter? Finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in this juz, Surah Al-Jathiyah. And Surah Al-Jathiyah, you can actually see the transition point between these surahs. So Surah Ash-Shura mentions, obviously the people consulting with one another and the people recognizing who Allah is and responding to that. Surah Az-Zukhruf mentions the ornaments in paradise, the gold ornaments in paradise, that which we're looking forward to. Surah Ad-Dukhan mentions the smoke that overwhelms people and the destruction of this earth. And then what do you have to look forward to? Those that used to deny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those that used to turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us now Al-Jathiyah, the nations that are on their knees in front of Allah. The nations that are on their knees in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the nations on the Day of Judgment. So Ad-Dukhan is the end of this world. Al-Jathiyah is the beginning of the next. Al-Jathiyah is the beginning of the hereafter when the nations are brought to their knees in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah mentions to us verse 24 through 28. Verse 24, وَقَالُوا مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهْرِ. And they say that there is nothing but our life of this world. We die and we live and nothing destroys us except time. مَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهْرِ. The only reason why we die is because our time expires. But there is, there is no such thing as resurrection. There is nothing that comes afterwards. مَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهْرِ. It is only time that does away with us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَإِذَا تُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُنَا بَيِّنَاتٍ مَا كَانُوا حُجَّتَهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ قَالُوا. I'm sorry. So, and when our clear verses are recited to them, the only argument that they have to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is they would say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, bring back our fathers, bring back aba'ana in kuntum sadiqeen. If you are truthful, then why don't you resurrect our fathers? Why don't you resurrect our parents? If you're telling us that we will be resurrected in the hereafter, then why don't you have our parents resurrected in this world and those that have passed before us resurrected in this world? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, respond, قُلِ اللَّهُ يُحْيِيكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives you life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives you death. ثُمَّ يَجْمَعُكُمْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And then He brings you back on the Day of Resurrection, about which there is no doubt, but most of mankind knows not. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ يَوْمَئِذٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm sorry, my voice is kicking out, so I guess that means that my time is up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to Allah belongs the kingdom of the kingdom of the heavens and the earth. وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ. And the day that the hour will be established, and on that day, يَخْسَرُ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. On that day, the followers of falsehood will lose everything. They will have nothing. وَتَرَى كُلَّ أُمَّةٍ جَاثِيَةً. And this is what the surah comes from. And you will see every nation kneel down. Every nation will be on its knees in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everyone is humbled before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every nation will be called to its record of deeds. And on that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-yawma tujzawna ma kuntum ta'malun. On that day, you will be compensated for everything that you have done. So, juzz 25 takes us from start to finish. It takes us from our attitude in this world to the attitude towards paradise, to those that deny the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world and leave nothing behind of benefit, until they are overwhelmed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the end of time. And then suddenly, the last scene of juzz 25 is every ummah on its knees. Every ummah is jathiyah, on its knees, kneeling out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be amongst those who are forgiven, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala overlook our shortcomings in this world, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who are comforted on the Day of Judgment, who are given security on the Day of Judgment, and may Allah give us the best of this world and the best of the next. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan for your continued du'as for my health. This has been an interesting Ramadan because of my throat, but alhamdulillah, inshallah ta'ala will continue. Tomorrow as well, Quran 30 for 30. But as I said, it's Friday and I have khutbah at 3 o'clock, which is 4 o'clock Eastern time. So I'll probably do it right before the khutbah, right after the khutbah, inshallah ta'ala. The charity that I want to invite you all to give to today is Sham Relief. Sham Relief is a charity that works for Syria. SubhanAllah, it's a local-based charity here in Dallas, mashallah, that does a lot of great work for the orphans in Syria. I know the brothers who run Sham Relief very well, and they do an amazing job working with the refugees and working with the orphans of Syria. So I'm going to invite you all, inshallah ta'ala, to donate today to Sham Relief, inshallah ta'ala, and I will put that in the comments, bidnillahi ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khairan, and I'll see you tomorrow, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.